Well, good morning and welcome to worship here at the Bloomer United Methodist Church. How is everybody doing? All right, well, it is warming up outside and hopefully we'll all stay cool in here. But I am excited for our time to be together. For those of you that are joining us online, we welcome you. We're glad that you're here with us in that medium. And if you're catching this later in your day or week, we're glad that you've stopped by to hang out with us in that way. Friends, as we come together in the spirit of worship, I'm going to invite us to just calm and center ourselves this morning. And I'm going to invite us to just clear everything out of our minds, the distractions, the busyness, and help us just focus all of our senses and attention upon the presence of the Holy Spirit in this place this morning. Friends, I invite you to hear these centering words. As we gather today, let us take a moment to reflect on the abundant gifts, talents, and authority God has entrusted to each of us. In His kingdom, stewardship is not simply about holding on to what we have, but about faithfully multiplying it for His glory. Amen. Friends, at this time, I'm going to invite us to join together in our opening worship. Our first song is He Leadeth Me. It is number 128 in your hymnal, or the words will be on the screen. We will sing verses 1 and 2, and I'm going to pass it over to Karen to lead us this morning. Please stand if you can comfortably do so.
Thank you.
Friends, will you pray with me this morning? Heavenly Father, we come before you with grateful hearts, recognizing that all we have comes from your hand. As we gather in your presence today, open our minds and hearts to your word. Help us to understand the depth of responsibility you have entrusted to us as stewards of your kingdom. Fill us with your wisdom and grace so that we may serve others faithfully and use the gifts you have given us to glorify your name. Guide us by your Spirit, and may all that we do bring honor to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Hi, friends, you may be seated this morning. All right, well, a couple of quick announcements for you this morning. The first, as usual, are the list of online resources that we have available to and for you. If you're ever not able to be here in person, you can always watch a live stream at this 10:30 time, or you can watch the recorded version of it on YouTube at your leisure a little bit later in the week. We also have some social media pages to show you what's going on in the life, ministry, and mission of the church, as well as to offer you some encouraging and devotional materials. And we just encourage you to engage with those and share those with your friends, families, and neighbors. Friends, if you have your announcement sheet this morning, again, just a reminder that the food pantry is looking for some more volunteers as they move into this fall period. And so if you have a little bit of time in your schedule, it sounds like they have a number of places, and they'll try to accommodate your schedule as much as possible. But if you would like to help out with that ministry, I invite you to either come see me or talk to the couple of people that are active in that organization already. And then finally, friends, yesterday we had our women's conference, and I understand that that was just an amazing experience. And so for all of the ladies that attended, we're thankful that you were able to come, and we pray that you have been ministered to and had value added to you. For all of you that organized and participated and led that conference, I just want to thank you for the important ministry and mission that went into putting that on. And I'm just going to continue to pray already for next year that it'll be even bigger and it will continue to grow. So just thank you to everyone that was a part of that. I guess anything else this morning? All right. Well, friends, let us continue our service this morning with our young disciples. Y'all want to come up here this morning quickly? All right, how are you all doing?
Good.
Yeah? So most of you have only got a week of freedom left, right? And then you're back to school or homeschool. All right, well, you better make the most of this last week, all right? So I'm pretty sure I've talked to you guys about this before, but how many of you remember the story in the Bible about the parable of the talents or the parable of the bags of gold? Anybody remember that story that Jesus tells? All right, well, let me recap it really quickly for you. So Jesus tells a story to people about a master who gives three servants some resources, bags of gold, essentially, okay? And to the first servant, he gives five bags. To the second one, he gives two bags. And to the third servant, he gives one bag, okay? And he says, I'm going away, so I'm putting this stuff in your charge, and you need to do good stuff with it so that when I get back, I can see what you've done. Okay, so anyway, long story short, the master comes back, and the first servant goes, look, master, you gave me five bags, I turned them into 10. The second one says, well, you gave me two bags, and I turned them into 4. And the last servant goes, well, I was really scared that I was going to lose it, and I didn't think you'd be very nice to me if I lost it, so I just dug a hole and put it in the ground. Okay? And then the master gets kind of mad at him. Remember that story now? Okay. So, I want to ask you a question today. What do you think is your bag of gold? If I had to ask you to look inside a bag of gold at all of the things that God has given you, what would be in there? Well, let's go with this then. How many hours in a day do you have? 12 hours in a day? Maybe that you're awake, right? 24 hours in a day we have, each of us. Do any of you have any money? Okay, a little bit. Some of you might have more than others. Okay. Are any of you guys good at things? Do you have any abilities or skills or talents? Well, some of you play sport. Some of you play instruments. Some of you are smart and do a lot of reading or play games, right? So you have all but different skills and abilities. Let's see. What else could we do? Do you guys have any material possessions? What's that? Okay. So you have clothes, you've got toys, you've got video game consoles, you've got a whole bunch of stuff, right? Well, I think we should think about those things, all of those things put together, and we each have a bag. Okay? So my question for you is, if the master came back, would he be proud of you at how you're utilizing all of those things? Kind of makes you think a little bit, doesn't it? Because not all of us use our time really well, do we? Sometimes we do goofy stuff. And then we have some of our money, but do we use our money to help other people, or do we just always spend it on us? And we have all these talents and abilities, but do we make them about how good we are at everything, or do we use those to help other people? Right? So if you play music, do you play it just so that you're the best guitarist or piano player, or do you play it to bring joy through the music that other people can have it? If you're really good at sports, is it all about how good you are, or are you helping make your team better? And if you're really smart and you do all the games and all the reading and all those things, are you using that knowledge to help other people, or are you just saying, oh, I'm the smartest one in the room? Okay? So, do you guys think that next week when you come back, you can give me a report on how you utilized your bag of gold this week? Right? Now here's the cool thing. Each of you has a different bag of gold. Right? Judah's bag is not the same as Dexter's, and Dexter's not the same as Desmond, Desmond's not the same as Trajan, and all the way around, right? Each person's bag of gold is a little bit different. But are you going to be like one of the two servants that go out and grow that bag of gold, or are you going to be the one that just spends it all on yourself or puts it in the ground and says, I don't want to lose any of this. This is all my stuff. Okay? Can you think about that this week? All right, older disciples, I'm going to come back to this same question and ask you guys a little bit later so you're not off the hook. All right? Okay, so next week, I want to hear a couple updates on how you used your bag of gold. All right, let me pray for you guys, and then you can go back and sit down. Dear gracious God, we thank you so much for these young disciples. We thank you for the amazing work that you are doing in their lives, and we thank you that they are here and that they're learning more and more about you every day. Lord, we also thank you for all of the things that you have given them, the skills, the talents, the abilities, the resources. Lord, help them this week to really be intentional about how they're going to utilize that bag of gold that you have given them. Lord, bless them and keep them, prepare them, and help them to enjoy this last week and prepare them for the school year ahead. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, you guys, you can go back and have a seat. All right. Well, friends, at this time, I'm going to invite us to join together in the giving and receiving of our tithes and offerings. And so if I can get a couple of our young disciples to come back up and to help me pass around the offering plates, I would greatly appreciate that. All right, friends. Well, I'm going to invite you to stand once again, if you can comfortably do so, as we sing our doxology together. Dear gracious God, we thank you and praise you for these tithes and these offerings, and we thank you for the generous heart of each and every person that gave this morning. Lord, we ask that you would grow and multiply these resources for use in your kingdom. Lord, that they would go to share your gospel message to the nations, and that they would go to serve people that are in need from our local community all the way to the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, you may be seated again this morning. All right, friends. Well, we are going to conclude our series, Empowered, Understanding the Authority of the Believer, this morning. And in doing so, we're going to talk about another set of themes. And we're going to talk about what it means to be ambassadors in the kingdom, as well as what it means to do stewardship in the kingdom. But before I get into that, I'm going to do just a really brief recap again, just in case you're joining us just for the first time or you've missed a week or two along the way. But in week one of our series, we looked at the world that we lived in, both this physical world, but also this supernatural kingdom that God ushered in and invited us to be a part of. In week two, we looked at the difference between the earthly systems of the world and how they generally try to help form our identity. And we looked at the difference between that and the kingdom reality. And we looked at the things that God said about us and the promises that were made to us and how those should be the basis for our identity. And then in week three, last week, we talked about what it means to live in that kingdom as citizens and to utilize a little bit of the authority that we have as citizens operating within the kingdom. So friends, let's take it to this last and final stage this morning. And as we do that, I want us to begin with the discussion of our terms. I want us to think about what it means to be an ambassador, as well as to consider what stewardship means. So let me ask you, what is an ambassador? What's that? Okay, someone that takes a message into the world. Okay. I think that's a good start. Okay, someone that represents a group or an organization. I think if we combine those two things, we've got a pretty good working definition. But here's the definition that comes from the dictionary. It says, a diplomatic official of the highest rank appointed and accredited as a representative in residence by one government or sovereign to another, usually for a specific length of time. All right, friends. Well, I want us to draw close attention to that couple of phrase where it says highest rank, right? Because have you ever thought of yourself as an ambassador? Have you ever thought that Jesus appoints you as an ambassador for his kingdom? He gives you the highest rank within the kingdom. Okay, so let me ask you this. If the President of the United States came to you today and said, Jan, I need you to go be an ambassador of the United States in this country, does your perspective on life change just a little bit? Yeah, probably it does, right? I know that if the President of the United States asked me to be an ambassador, I'd be thinking, oh my gosh, I don't know if I'm equipped to do this, right? I better hurry up and I better go study the culture and the language and the history and all of the things that it's going to entail to go be an ambassador there. And I also think I'd have to really reflect on what it means to be an American citizen, right? Because now I'm not just a citizen operating only in America, but I'm looking out for the very best interests of America in a foreign place, right? And my job is to be diplomatic and strategic, to work out diplomatic arrangements between that nation and my nation. It's also my job to ensure that citizens that come from the United States into the country that I'm at, that they're kept safe and that their rights are guaranteed by the nation that they come to, right? And so, friends, many of us, I think, often walk around as with this small perspective, if you will, of what it's like to live into the kingdom. But I think if we really take on this theme of being an ambassador, which Paul speaks about in his letter to the 2 Corinthians, he says, so we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God. For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be an offering for our sin, so that we could be made right with God through Christ. Okay, so Paul uses this metaphor of ambassadors for us to live into the kingdom, right? To go out and to proclaim the gospel message to all the nations. It matches the same imperative that Jesus gives us. Go make disciples of all nations, teaching them to obey everything that I have told you to, right? But friends, it also goes back again to the very beginning, because this is the same thing God did in Genesis when he made Adam and Eve, and he says, look, go out into the world and be my ambassadors. You're to be a light to all the nations. And that follows through the whole history of Israel. They're to be a light of the nations. They're supposed to point in their ambassadorship, in the things they do and the way they live, they're always supposed to be pointing back to God. All right, so with that in place, let's go take a look quickly at this idea of stewardship. So when I use the word stewardship, what comes to mind? Money, giving of oneself, okay. All right, friends, well, most of the time when we talk about stewardship, especially in the church, it has to do with money, right? I do a stewardship almost every fall where we talk a little bit about money, but I also believe stewardship is a whole lot more than money. It's all of the things that we have access to. Okay, but one of the differences in understanding stewardship is that we also recognize that stewardship is an active component, right? So often when we think of stewardship, we think of conservation. We have to manage and conserve the resources that we have, right? And I believe that that's partially true. That is our job, to be good managers, good stewards, if you will, of the things that we have. But what Jesus calls us to do is to take that and make it active, right? Not to be in scarcity saying, oh, I only have so much, so I have to conserve what little bit I have or I might run out. He says, no, take the little bit you have and go make more of it. Okay? And that's a big difference when we think about stewardship. Now again, stewardship, as we've already alluded to, includes all aspects of life. Our gifts, our talents, our time, our influence, and how we wrap up and utilize all of those for the glory of God. Now, this morning, as you can see, I have a couple of different scriptures this morning from the Gospel of Matthew, but I want to just highlight quickly, when we talk about kingdom authority, and especially as our in the role as ambassador and as stewards of the kingdom, I want us to be very clear that the purpose of the authority that's granted to us by Jesus and the reason we have the resources that we've been given is not for our own glory, right? Because think of what would happen if an ambassador of the United States went over to some other country and just began spending all of the United States' resources for his own his or her personal gain. Would we be very happy with that? Would we conclude that that's the best use of his or her role as an ambassador? Okay? So, friends, when we talk about our ambassadorship and we talk about being disciples and citizens, the point isn't that we elevate ourselves and our status, but rather that we understand that we're under the head of someone else. But yet we have authority granted to us by the God who is the head, who is the king, who is the president, whatever language you want to fit in this political context, to go and to do this. The same thing happens when we look at all of the resources that we have been given, right? Because we can make all of the things about us, oh, look at how much money I make, look at how gifted I am at this, look at how influential, how successful. Right? But is that really the way God calls us to steward those things? Or do we humble ourselves and say, you know what? I have this money so that I can help other people. I have this time so that I can care for the people God puts in my path. I have these talents and skills and abilities so that I can edify and help equip and help grow and lead people into transformation and into healing. And so as you look at that Matthew 20 verse, we need to remember that even some of the disciples got caught up in this idea of making things about them, right? That Matthew 20, 25 through 28, which I'm not going to read this morning, is about the sons of Zebedee, right? And their mother comes to Jesus and says, hey, Jesus, I'm really excited about what you're doing with my sons, and we believe that you are the Messiah and the Son of God. Do you think my sons can sit on your right and left hand? Can they be in positions of power and status in your kingdom? Because that'd be really cool. And Jesus asked them, well, do you think you're capable of drinking the cup that I drink? And of course they're like, oh yes, we can drink the cup that you're going to drink. And we'd love to sit at your right and left hand. And just as Jesus says, well, okay, you can drink the cup that I'm going to drink, but you don't get to sit at my right and left hand because that's not for me to give to you. Right? And so that's the story there. But friends, think of how easy, especially in our culture, it is to make things about us, right? Where everything in life revolves around us in the things that we want. So friends, authority is meant for service, and we're to reflect Christ's example to the people throughout the world. Now, friends, let's go in and let's look at our scripture today, which again should be very familiar to most of you. It is Matthew 25, verses 14 to 30. It's the parable of the bags of gold, or the parable of the talents, which I've already paraphrased, but we'll read it again. And so Jesus says here, again, again referring to the kingdom of heaven, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. To one he gave 5 bags of gold, to another 2, and to another 1 bag, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. The man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 bags more. So also the one with 2 bags of gold gained 2 more, and the man who had received 1 bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received 5 bags brought the other 5, and he said, "Master," he said, "you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in a few things, so I'm going to put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." The man with 2 bags of gold also came. "Master," he said, "you entrusted me with 2 bags of gold, and see, I gained 2 more. His master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things, and so I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." Then the man who received 1 bag of gold came. "Master," he said, "I knew that you were a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid, and I went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you." His master replied, "You wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. Why? Well, then you should have put the money at deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. So take the bag of gold from him and give it to one who has 10 bags. For whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken away from them, and throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness where there'll be a weeping and a gnashing of teeth." All right, friends, so let's go back and let's take a look at the beginning of this passage, because there's a few things that I think are really important. So as you think about some of the parables that Jesus offers up, have you ever noticed how intentional he is about the use of masters and servants? Have you ever paid attention to that in the parables? Right? So many times I think it's easy just to go like, "Oh, it's just a story like any fairy tale we would believe," or "Oh, that was just the custom back at the time, so we don't really talk about servants and masters anymore because we don't really like that type of an arrangement." But the thing about it is that again, friends, we need to understand that when we live in the kingdom of God, again, the system, the political system, is a monarchy, which means we have a king. So when Jesus uses language like master and servant, it's very intentional because he says, "Look, there's a master, my father, and he gives you certain things, and you have to decide how you're going to work with those." Okay? And so again, it sets us up right away for us to understand that it's not about us. Right? That we're here to serve the master with the things that we have been given. Now, the other thing is that he gives things to people according to their ability. Right? Again, we really struggle with that because in our culture today, we think everybody should have all of the same stuff, that there should be equality of outcomes in everything. But Jesus says, "No, I've given certain people abilities and talents and skills for them to use," right? And I don't think Jesus really cares whether you have a little bit or whether you have a lot. I think he looks at your heart and say, "How did you use those things that I gave you?" All right? So friends, as we look at this, one of the first things I want us to consider is that stewardship requires action, okay? It's active. It's not this idea of just taking and hiding things and conserving things for ourselves or even for the small group that we might handle. So when we put this in terms of the authority of the believer, does the master, once he gives the resources to the people, does the master stand over their shoulder and micromanage everything that they do? No. Right? He doesn't. He says, "Look, Here's 5 bags of gold. Here's 2 bags. Here's 1 bag. Go out and utilize these for use in my kingdom. And then he goes away. Right? Friends, how many of us sit here and we wonder what we should do with the resources God has given us? Right? Or we sit there and ask God to micromanage us, saying, well, God, what should I do with this? And God, what should I do with this? And God, what should I do with this? And what plan should I make over here? And what should I do with this? Right? As if we're just expecting this supernatural plan to just descend on us in tablets of stone, saying, here is exactly what you're supposed to do with everything that you have been given. Now, does that mean that we don't go to God in prayer, that we don't seek out to be in alignment with the things that God has with us? Absolutely not, because that's important, right? But God gives us the authority to say, look, I trust you. I've made you an ambassador of my kingdom. I'm giving you one of the highest ranks in my kingdom. And you don't have to worry about the resources in my kingdom because they're not going to run out. But take these resources that I've given you and go and grow them. Go find a way to put these to use according to the values of the kingdom that I have brought forth. So friends, I want you to go back to the young disciples, and I'm going to invite you now. What's your bag of gold? What's the talent that you've been given? What are all the things that make up that resource for you? And how have you been living? Have you been outgrowing that as often and as intentionally as you can? Have you been burying it in the ground going, well, I sure don't really want to lose any of this, because if I lose it, maybe God's not going to be very happy? Or have you done the exact opposite and have you just taken it for yourself? Right? Now, that's not in the scriptures, but it seems like we could really do that for ourselves, where we could really make things about our needs, our desires, and our comfort at the expense of how God calls us to utilize the resources that we've been given. And so, friends, we watch as the first two stewards, the first two servants, go out and actively put the resources that the master gives them to use. And amazingly, because I believe they're done in the right spirit and in the right intention, they see double the return on their investment. The third one, however, has some real major problems. First, he has a really bad perspective of who the master is. Right? He says, Master, I thought you were a really hard person. I didn't believe you had a really good heart. You go and do all of these things, and I was afraid that that you might look down upon me if I lost this or I didn't grow this the way you wanted me to. And what happens to him? Friends, fear paralyzes him. And he digs a hole and he just puts it in the ground out of fear. And so, friends, I'm going to talk specifically to you guys as a church this morning, because you're entering into a time where that could be your choice. Given the transitions that are coming up, given some of the things that are on your plate as churches, you could opt for fear. And you could say, you know what, we have to conserve all of the things that we have. We have to make sure that we don't run out of this. We have to make sure that we just take care of ourselves. But is that what God wants for you? God has given you as a people a bag, as a church, a bag of gold. And he says, here, church, here's your resources. Go out and grow these resources. Put these resources to use in my kingdom. And friends, that's my prayer for you as a church, that as we move forward, you don't let fear paralyze you. And that you take on the role of the first two servants in doing good and faithful work. Now, friends, there's another couple things, and I alluded to this earlier, that, again, God rewards the faithfulness, not the results. Right? Because so often we can look at this and go, well, gosh, this guy got 5 bags of gold. He had such an advantage, and he goes out and he makes 5 more. But again, friends, I don't think that's what Jesus is saying, right? And there are a lot of Christians who take it to mean that, oh, I just get to have all the material abundance and wealth that I want because I'm doing all of these things. But no, it's about, are you faithfully living out and using the things that you have? And maybe you'll make some mistakes along the way, right? Maybe you'll lose a little bit at first. But if you learn from that and you keep coming back to Jesus faithfully saying, okay, am I in alignment? Am I walking in obedience and utilizing all of the things you've given me for your kingdom purposes? Are all of the things that I'm doing, are they bringing honor and glory to you, God, or are those things misplaced? And friends, I do believe that there's deep wisdom in this, in that if you are faithful with the things you have been given, you'll be given more. I really do believe that. I don't think that's just a prosperity gospel thing. I think when you are faithful with the things that you have been given, if you live them out, you'll find that God expands the use of those gifts and those resources, those talents, whatever it is, God will expand them. But with more resources also comes more responsibility, because you don't get to just keep being a big fish in a small pond, right? God said, look, I just gave you more. I bumped you up from 2 bags to 5 bags. You get to go up and do even more now to glorify me through the use of these resources. And finally, friends, as we consider the role of ambassadorship and stewardship, we understand that in God's kingdom there's accountability, right? And many times when we read this story, we really don't like the end of it, right? It's not a happily ever after story where everybody just gets all the same stuff and everybody's treated the same, right? No, the guy that disobeyed, the guy that wasn't faithful with it, he gets his bag taken away and he gets thrown out and he says, look, you're out of here. And so friends, again, we serve a king, right? And the king is a good king. But if we're not going to walk in obedience, if we're not going to do the things that the king wants us to do, if we're not going to utilize the resources the way the king wants us to, then don't be surprised when we run into accountability where, like I said last week, there's going to come a time where each of us are going to stand before Jesus and we're going to give an account of every single thing that we've done in this life. And what, again, my hope and prayer is like for the first two servants, well done. So friends, with that, as you consider what it means to walk in that authority, again, understand that your authority comes through obedience and trust. Trusting that the king is a good king, he's a good master. Trusting that the resources of the kingdom are never going to run out. Right? I think that's one of the beauties of this church that we have been given. Each person here has a different bag of gold, and it can be used to support and to edify other people in this church. It can be utilized to go out and transform this community and the world outside. But will we walk in trust and will we obey? Will we make sure we're in alignment with the places that God is leading us? So friends, I'm going to give you a call to action that's the exact same as the young disciples. And so now that you've considered what your bag of gold is, how can you go out this week and utilize that bag for the glory of the kingdom and of its king? Yeah.
Can you hear me? So the Holy Spirit is stirring me, so I get to just nail something down that Josh is saying. And, you know, he spoke about ambassadorship, right? He talked about the president sending you to a foreign country. And I believe what the Holy Spirit wants you to know today is that your home is the kingdom of God. And earth is the foreign land that you're in. And so think about that, put it in that perspective for a while. And then take that call to action and see what the Lord's asking you to do. So thank you.
Thank you. Friends, with that, end of our time, we will stand before our Maker and He will say, well done, good and faithful servant. Come and enjoy life with me and enjoy my happiness. My friends, God bless and amen. Friends, at this time, I'm going to invite us to move into a time of prayer, and I ask if there's any prayer concerns or any joys that you would all like to lift up and to share this morning. Prayers for the Walsh family. Debbie's granddaughter has a mass on her liver, and so we just pray for testing and healing for her, as well as for Dwayne and for placement, that he can receive the care and the help that he needs today. And also just be with Debbie, because she's been carrying a load for a long time, so prayers of comfort and peace for her as she continues to support and minister to her family. Michelle.
Maybe ask for continued prayers for Stella. She's still in a coma, but she's slowly making improvements, but it's going to be a long road. And then Diane Liskacek from the New Auburn Church, her brother Dwayne fell, and there's healing, and he's on hospice and things. Just pray for his comfort. And then continued prayers for Angela. Showed
some cysts and a herniated disc on her back. All right, so continued prayers for Stella, that she would continue to improve and heal, be with her family, as that is a difficult and long road for them. Prayers for Diane Blaskacek, her brother is on hospice. She too has had a pretty rough road over the years, and then also for Angela, for her back. So, anything else this morning? Marianne?
With the joy of Kara having Nora Dolores here today, and then Monet, my niece, had her baby on Monday, a little boy, 8 pounds, and his name is Lincoln. So, joy for that.
Good. All right. So yes, some joy as we've got some new kiddos. So Kara, congratulations to you and to Josh and Haas. Better be nice to her. You better treat her well or she'll get you in trouble. I'm telling you, you poke her too many times and she'll cry. But blessings to you guys on that, and blessings to Monet and her, and their family on the birth of their son as well. Anything else? Nelda.
My husband, Charlie, they thought he had COVID, but he didn't have COVID. He had bronchitis, and they treated the bronchitis, and then he was better, but now it's worse again, and so now they think he's got pneumonia, and he's going to have a CAT scan to find out if he's got pneumonia, but regardless, he's not feeling well.
Okay, so prayers for Charlie. We pray that he gets the care that he needs and healing for him as well. Cheryl.
I have a joy. I recently heard from Rita, and after her last visit to the doctor, she
Good. All right. So Cheryl gave us an update on Rita, who is doing well and has come off one of her medications. And so just praise God for that. And we pray that she just continues to thrive and move through that recovery from the things that she had facing her earlier. Juanita.
My son Arnold has been having a day-to-day battle with cortisol. And on September 4th, we have an appointment with a specialist. So we're just praying that he'll be taken care of somehow.
All right, so for Juanita's son, Arnold, dealing with bouts of vertigo, that is not a fun thing to have, and so hopefully they can find something to alleviate that. Anything else this morning? Olivia.
This lady at the clothes closet, Betty Weber, she fell at the post office and broke a leg, but now she has developed a blood clot on her leg. So they have her a leg here for that.
Okay, what was her name?
Betty.
Betty. Weber. So prayers for Betty, who took a fall, just prayers of healing for her so that she can recover and get back to the work that she does. Well, friends, let us take these things and anything else that may be on your heart and mind in a moment of silent prayer. Dear gracious and loving God, we thank you and we praise you for this day that you have given us and for our opportunity to be here to worship and glorify you. Lord, this day I just ask that you would continue to equip all of us to walk in the authority that you have given us and that we might be good stewards of the resources that you have placed in our lives. Lord, this day you have heard the prayer requests and the joys of this people, and Lord, we are a people in need of your healing power and work. And so, Lord, we pray for Debbie's granddaughter and her husband, for Stella, for Diane's brother, for Angela, Betty, Arnold, Charlie. Lord, we just ask that your healing hand would come down and be placed on each and every one. Lord, that your healing power would flow through them and that their body will begin to recover, that the symptoms would be gone and that there would be healing. Lord, we also pray for the doctors in medical facilities, Lord, that they would be able to find space and place to do the tests, to have rooms available, and to do their best work. And Lord, we thank you for the joys of life, for the successful healing for Rita, and for the birth of new children for Nora and for Lincoln. Lord, we just ask that your hand continue to be upon them and bless these growing families, Lord. Just give them and equip them and continue to make this transition and enjoy this time together. Lord, we ask all of these things in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, will you join me in our Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, at this time, I'm going to invite you to join me in our closing song, Go Make of All Disciples. It is number 571 in your hymnal. We'll sing verses 1 and 4. I invite you to stand if you can comfortably do so, and I'm going to invite Karen to lead us once again. And now, my friends, as you go from this place, may you walk in the fullness of your calling, knowing that you are stewards of God's kingdom. May His wisdom guide you, His Spirit empower you, and His love flow through you as you serve others and advance His purposes here on earth. My friends, God bless and have an amazing week. Amen.